Welcome to yet another edition of Setting the Pace, the show that gives you the inside track to the world of Kenyan runners. I'm Martin Kaner. Athletics, like any other sport, is very competitive, and some athletes may be tempted to take drastic measures for that coveted first place. On today's show, we have Elias Makori, a sports editor with the Daily Nation and a member of the IFFF Press Commission. Welcome.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
We also have Lawrence Miano, a Nyahururu sports administrator. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
Yes. So on today's show, we would like to focus on why an athlete would take a shortcut track to success and ask, do our Kenyan athletes use performance-enhancing drugs?
If you look at those people, they wake up very early in the morning. They work out, they watch what they eat. They work every day on what they want, and they are very focused.
I don't think Kenyan athletes use drugs because basically it's something that they've been good at it.
I believe in them, and I believe in their training. And I've never had such a thing in Kenya.
They work so hard. Please, let's give credit where it's due.
I am sure that they go under vigorous tests before they enter into the game.
So, gentlemen, that was an interesting video on doping. What are your thoughts, Elias?
Well, it's a reality. Mm-hmm. It's something we cannot run away from. Mm-hmm. It's very true. There are some athletes in Kenya who are doping, and this is an issue that should be taken very, very seriously. Okay. It's not about, the German guy coming to get a good story. He actually was in Kenya for a few months, posing as an agent. So people really didn't know what he was doing, and that's how he came up with the revelations. Mm-hmm. And it's very good that he raised the alarm at this time, because our young athletes are really being misled by unscrupulous agents. So it's something that's there.
Okay, that's a very good point. Lawrence, what do you think?
To me, mm-hmm. I don't believe that our athletes take drugs. I've been sports administration for over 30 years. Mm-hmm. And I remember even you yourself, mm-hmm. you ran Nyahururu.
Yes.
Our athletes eat very strong type of diet from childhood to where they grow up. So the strength that they have is not because of doping. They don't. I don't agree that.
Well, I agree. There's a majority of the athletes work very, very hard, and they train hard, and, they toe the straight line, basically. But, sports being a microcosm of life, there's always going to be a few individuals who are going to cheat, regardless whether we like it or not. And unfortunately, here in Kenya, with the sheer number of athletes running and really basically chasing after the same pie, don't you think that there may be a few that could actually be misled to dope?
Well, in athletics, or rather in sports, athletes are sportsmen.
Yes.
We can't compare them with football, where there's competition. Mm-hmm. They run for honors, mm-hmm. to be honored. And when a Kenyan flag is being hoisted outside the world, how you feel the
pride. It's a proud moment, yeah.
Yeah. Huge, so proud that moment. Is the honor that we've been looking for. So if there are, mm-hmm. I can see a one or mm-hmm. two, especially in the 800 meters women, mm-hmm. I had it, mm-hmm. but I did not prove it. To me, I wait it to be proved. Mm-hmm. But as far as I'm concerned, these are rumors. To me, they are rumors.
I think, this is not the first time that there's been allegations to the effect that Kenyan athletes dope. In 1999, remember, there was a Swiss news report that stated that there's doping in Kenya. What do you think of that? I mean, is that true?
Yeah, that's it. It's very true because, if you look at the history of some athletes, it doesn't really add up. Mm-hmm. A good example is one of the guys who was caught doping. He'd run in the U.S., I think Philadelphia, then he landed in Nairobi. Following day, he was running a half marathon in Nairobi, mm-hmm. looking for 20,000 shillings. Mm-hmm. So, I blame the government also. It's not a matter of saying to Nomba Serikali, but mm-hmm. the government has played a role. The cost of living has gone up. These guys need money. Mm-hmm. They pick on any race they want, just to make the money. And the managers are doping them to make them, keep
so
up.
Of course, I agree. Yeah. I think a lot of, the competition, the sheer number of athletes has increased. you know, from back when I was running in the mid-90s. I mean, if you look at the, you know, the number of people in training venues, like training towns like Nyahururu, Iten, Eldoret, Kapsabet, Kericho, I mean, they've increased. And what it basically boils down to is everybody wants that piece of the big athletic pie, which is there's big money now in road races, marathons, and everybody wants to get out of poverty or their level of living. And I think money is a big driver in the influence of doping. It really is.
Driver.
And so it is. It
because
is.
And so, the other thing, Martin, I mean, we should be self-policing, I believe, because mm-hmm. if you look at, I've been to Iten a couple of times, not a couple, several times, mm-hmm. and you find a white guy from Europe living in a one-roomed house. You wonder what he's doing there. He doesn't have the papers to be a manager. His immigration is, you know, dubious. Mm-hmm. Talking about as recently as 3 weeks ago, you know, there's some guys who were thrown out of the country because they didn't have the papers.
Okay, and so why do you think there's an increase in doping?
Now, to me, the government wrote a very good paper called Sports Policy. Mm-hmm. It's kept in archives of the government. Up to now, nothing has come out. The system of running sports in this country, mm-hmm. the ministers for sports have really let us down. Okay. Because there's no sports policy, there's no sports bill. You hear them say, the next day they are saying about it. So the government is to blame wholly for this problem. Because one, how does this person pass the immigration and deposits as a coach? He goes to Iten because most of them goes to camp in Iten.
Okay.
I caught one in Nyahururu.
Yes, that's a good point. Yeah. But back in the day, Miano, did you hear of any of these allegations?
You were training back in Nyahururu in 1997.
Yes.
When Puma was a team and they saw you. Mm-hmm. You're training under
yes,
my stadium.
I had a big group of training mates over there.
And
but back then, were there any other allegations? I know I didn't hear any,
there is
but
one
beyond
thing,
that,
there's one thing that I have to now complain. Mm-hmm. Some Europeans, mm-hmm. used to come with, that's the first time I saw them taking videos. Mm-hmm. When you people, and I complained one day, were starting the 100 meters there, they could yes. put a video camera on the ground. They start counting your steps, one, two, up to where, up to the edge of the 100 meters.
Yeah.
And then, one time I went and told him, what are you doing with that video? And he told me, I'm the manager. Mm-hmm. And so that was one way. They started
okay.
now creating the idea that those people are so good because
yeah,
they are better
be doing
than other people.
Yes.
They must be taking some people.
But do you hear, even before our group came in the mid or late 90s, did you ever hear of any allegations before that?
Never.
Never. Okay.
We used to run for cries and sufurias and small things. So,
so there's less incentive really to dope back
yeah.
then.
Yeah,
sorry,
actually,
no?
the mm-hmm. only time you know such a thing came up was when John Googie refused to take an out-of-competition
yes.
test. And that was not doping. That was, you
yes.
know...
Just ignorance,
out
basically.
Of ignorance.
Absolutely.
That's why education is important.
Correct. Mm-hmm. Because if he knew...
Mm-hmm. He would absolutely...
He would completely have accepted. But he didn't know. And nobody came to advise Googie what he was supposed to do. Yet, they, up to today, they say that Googie refused. And Googie... He's for my place. And I feel a bitter.
Yeah, I do. It. I mean, I think that Googie's situation was different in the sense that you know, the process that he was being tested was pretty much a surprise. You know, somebody shows up at your house and says, "I want your urine sample." Of course, you're going to say no. You know, the first thing in the morning. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, the repercussions of that action is that if you refuse a drug test. You know, you're basically branded as somebody who was tested positive, like any other.
You're
you know, that's and you're banned. You know, and that's really you know your career is ruined because of that. And so it comes down to education. You know, athletes. You know, once they reach a certain level, you know, whether they have a coach or not, you know, whether it's their athletes, you know, their fellow athletes who have to advise them. And look, once you reach a certain level, you have to understand that these things are the certain drugs. Well, certain medicines are banned and certain processes. If somebody comes and asks for your urine sample and you have to identify themselves, you know, this is what happens. Otherwise, the repercussions are very, very bad for their career. And so these are the things that I think, you know, we must, you know, as local influencers and opinion leaders, must continue to push, you know, so that athletes understand. Because doping, you know, in Kenya is you know, it's really unfortunate, you know, but we must do something to assist our athletes, you know, not get into the doping. Elias, I think, you know, the recent allegations by this German TV report, that implicated some athletes. You know, it has dealt a big blow to the reputation of Kenya. What can we do to change that?
I think even the Ministry of Health needs to come in very strongly, because the main local races we have, we should actually make it compulsory to have dope testing. I mean, we need to increase our capacity for testing.
Certainly.
At the moment, I think the biggest lab we have around here is in South Africa. The samples have to go down south.
Yes, they have to go down.
Yeah, so we need to build our capacity for testing locally and educating the athletes. Mm-hmm. And also about, you know, things like in WADA, the World Anti-Doping Association, they have the whereabouts rule, mm-hmm. where an athlete has to say where he is at a particular time, any time mm-hmm. of, you know, the week. They'll call you. If you're not where you say you are, they give you a warning. Second time, they don't get you, they give you another warning. Third time, it's called, you know, doping.
Yes.
So this kind of education is what most athletes don't have. So the Ministry of Health really needs to build the capacity of labs, and we must test during even the smallest races we have.
Absolutely. Yeah. Lawrence Miano, you've been involved in the sport since the 80s, and what do you think has changed? What's happening now? Why are these allegations surfacing?
I believe that in sports, what has changed right now is competition. The competition has changed very greatly. An athlete today, he should forget about their competition and go for honors. You know, in football or in other games, they are trying to look for shortcuts. Mm-hmm. And that's what our athletes are trying to look for shortcuts. And there's a difference between a sportsman, mm-hmm. sportsmanship, mm-hmm. and a competition.
Absolutely.
Because this man who is a sportsman mm-hmm. goes for honor. Mm-hmm. But for this one who's going for competition, he goes for winning. Mm-hmm. So they are taking the shortcut to go and win, to score a goal.
Yeah, that's an interesting point. Elias, what do you think?
Yeah, I mean, track and field athletics has become so commercial that people, especially the agents, are stopping at nothing to make sure they get the money. So you get an athlete being used as a guinea pig. Most of the guys in the North Rift, mm-hmm. young kids who are running, you know, half a marathon at 19. I mean, that's it's unacceptable.
Yes,
why do they get onto the road? Because of making a quick buck and to keep them going.
Let me ask you.
They get doped.
What age is an athlete supposed to run a half marathon?
Late 20s, early 30s. You know, I think the idea really is for a lot of these athletes to develop the speed on the track and then move up to the marathon or the half marathon when they're, you know, because if at 19 they've never really hit the track, they're obviously tempted by the money on the roads. By 23, you know, of course, the impact of racing on the roads, it takes a toll on the body.
At what age did you start running half marathon?
I never really ran half marathon. I stuck to the track. But the people in my era, the guys who moved up from the track to the half marathon, did so in their late 20s, early 30s.
Correct.
And that was the trend. But now, you know, you say correctly, so many young athletes are going up to the marathon because, you know, there may not be as much money on the track, but they find that there's a greater allure on the roads. And, you know, that money is the first influencer on these athletes. And, you know, agents will do whatever it takes to get the youngest, the most freshest young athlete to get onto the roads.
Yeah, because we've been asking Martin, I mean, why is Kenya not winning any medals in a 10K?
Yes.
On the track, 10,000 meters, 5,000 mm-hmm. meters, because the guys are not there. I mean, they don't...
Yeah, and it's money is a big influence.
Is
a big influence.
Who's to blame for this?
You're the people in athletics.
You guys
in management are to blame.
Absolutely. Yeah, you have to do something about it, the management level. But I think, you know, inspiring the athletes to stick to the track, you know, because of course it lengthens their career. So because their careers are short and it's very competitive, they'll do whatever it takes. And, you know, I think, you know, this, you know, the second, third tier, you know, they see the successes that athletes, you know, their colleagues have. And they think that this, you know, I've got to make the money and I'll do whatever it takes.
People talk.
You know, absolutely.
When we go for meetings, they talk. Mm-hmm. They say after age of 20 and above, that's the time you're supposed to run a marathon. At the age of 19, you are still a teenager. You should not run this marathon. Yeah. So rules should not be kept under.
That's it. Mm-hmm. They don't enforce the rules. And, you know, look at what's happened in cycling. Mm-hmm. The Tour de France,
yes,
you know, Lance Armstrong. And it's been a big problem where the police are actually busting the hotels of these teams, you know, Confidis and all these teams.
Yeah.
Same thing has happened in football.
Mm-hmm.
But now Kenya is an easy target, so to speak. Our borders are porous. We have guys coming in. as posing as agents. The guy who wrote the story was posing as an agent. Nobody knew about him.
I think that, you know, a lot of young athletes can't handle the pressure or the success or the money, you know, when, you know, they receive a huge windfall of money from a particular race. Is that why they resort to drugs or substance abuse or, you know, drinking?
I believe because right now I won 1.2 million shillings. I bought a car worth about 600,000. I'm left with about 600,000 shillings. I drink and I joke about I marry five wives or anything I want. Some are even cheated. they are married at a very young age. So what happens? They are now trying to run away from the public. And they, because I want to go back, I have to think, what am I going to do? Look, there are some athletes who can even take the beer overnight. But you know, my genes are not like yours.
Yes,
so when you go to the competition level tomorrow, I might beat you. And because you have seen that I was drinking tonight, my coach was saying, yule, si alishida kwa klabu jana. Na leo ameshida, hata mimi nitaenda kwa pombe.
I think, okay, I'll give you an interesting tidbit. The first person to ever test positive for drugs or substance abuse was in the 68 Olympics, where somebody from Sweden was found to have drank two beers, and that had him thrown out of the Olympics. Substance abuse also is an issue amongst our athletes. Do you think so?
Definitely. I know about quite a number of few athletes who have become addicted because of beer. Beer. Okay. And finally, you see that they are not even there. They hide away. They run away. Some even are told, go back to work where you have been working before because you cannot be able to make it.
So there's a lot of education needed and counseling. Once an athlete gets into that problem, you need to know how to manage him. Most of our athletes don't know how to manage their own success. I mean, I'm not afraid to mention Samuel Anjiru. That was his biggest problem.
Yes.
Instead of his management company trying to, you know, manage his success and really put him in the straight and narrow, they let him to his own devices, and he had the money he could spend. I remember a few occasions I actually got him in a bar once and told him, no, you don't belong here, Sammy, and I walked out with him.
I agree, you know, counseling and education is very, very important.
Even the barman should be told, you know, this guy is a Boston
Marathon. He's a world-famous athlete.
Don't sell him beer because he has a race to come.
Selling water instead of beer, right?
Yeah. Now, Laikipia University College has come up with a program of educating our local athletes and coaches. And in fact, we have held three consecutive workshops in Laikipia. And we've got people coming all the way from Eldoret to learn about this. We have trainers. We have doctors who comes and trains them in Laikipia University.
That's very good.
We have even a course starting with the Minister of Sports is sending some people to train them about sports management, which drugs is part of it. Money management is a part of it. And so all this management as a whole for sports. So I believe if we can get such organizations, so many organizations dealing with that, it's very important. And we should do this place, this thing everywhere.
Let's talk about the social impact again. You know, what does it mean for a community or an athlete? What happens to an athlete
when an athlete wins, let's say he or she goes for out of the country and comes with about one or two million shillings. The local people are very happy about it.
Yes.
But when this athlete, the money gets finished because of his, most of our young athletes go to pubs. Some even reach their homes after 3 or 4 weeks. By the time they reach their homes, they have got brokers who are waiting for them to buy plus and everything. By the end of the day, this that's nothing. So the people there now start to look at him. So because he won't go back to that limelight, he has to go back now. He would even try to hide because he does not want to be seen by the local people. So the social, it affects him very much that he even does not want to see any of his family.
Yeah. Now, going back to the topic again, you know, I mean, there's one or two high-profile cases this year. And, you know, Elias, you know, being in the media, what do you think needs to be done about this, you know, these allegations? Are they, I mean, if they're true or not, I mean, what needs to be done about this, really?
I think education is key because most of the athletes, you know, wouldn't know they're doping. Many of them are doping without knowing. You know, it's as basic as if you take two cups of very strong coffee, that's doping, too much caffeine in your system. They don't know that. You used to have that very, you know, potent cold drug, Kofta.
Yes.
You take one tablet, Kofta, that's doping.
Yes.
Many of them don't know that. Yeah. But on the other hand, there's some crazy agents who are coming in. They're using them as guinea pigs.
You know, the World Anti-Doping Association has 250 banned substances. And you can imagine a lot of our athletes coming from a very rural background wouldn't know half of it, wouldn't know what's legal or illegal. You know, of course, there's different kinds of, you know, there's some drugs that actually, it takes a concerted effort, you know, to dope. You know, a lot of the blood doping techniques, the modern blood doping techniques, you know, where you have to monitor your blood, those kinds of things. Of course, you know, there is a concerted effort. A lot of these, you know, they may not understand that there's 250 different types of drugs. Some are stimulants and some are much more serious, steroidal. Blood doping. Yeah, it is a good point. A lot of guys don't know.
Now, I completely support what he's talking about, the education. Mm-hmm. But who is to be educated? Mm-hmm. Are we waiting for this manager from Europe to come and educate our people? Mm-hmm. We need to educate our people from the ground.
Absolutely.
That small person, that teacher from the primary school who is starting that child from grassroots, who leaves the child when she comes or he comes up to form four or when he goes to university, that's the person who is supposed to be trained. When he or she is trained, then she will now be able to train to tell the athletes, his three or four athletes, that now he becomes a coach. Mm-hmm. So education, as he what he has said, is very, very important.
Very key, I agree. Yeah. But social effects, what will happen to an athlete socially?
That's where counseling comes in, because an athlete will really be an outcast. I mean, people will shun him or her. Mm-hmm. You'll be looked as a cheat. But what I'm saying here is that there's redemption. You can always bounce back because there's doping knowingly and there's, you know, when you take a substance that you didn't know actually is a banned. So you'll be banned by the RAAF and people will say, this guy cheated. The examples that we must mention of people really bounced back. Mm-hmm. Look at Justin Gatlin. He was out and he got a medal in the Olympics.
Yes,
Lydia Chirome, own Lydia Chirome, she was accused of using a banned substance. She was not doping, but she was using medication, which was on the list.
Mm-hmm.
How do these people recover? You need to counsel them, you know, tell them, okay, you get a 2-year ban, but you can bounce back. But if you run away from them,
that's an issue.
It.
But I believe if you go back in 1860s, where Kipchoge Keino was going Agon Hill. Mm-hmm. Those people are training so hard. And our winning did not come just because of the drugs. It came because of nature. Mm-hmm. They were training so hard, Akina Ben Gipcho, Serafino Antao, all those people of the old time. They were very good. Mm-hmm. And the strength of our athletes come from the background, from the food that we eat. The sweet potatoes, the bananas, the musik,
the
safais, and everything. All these things are natural.
Another thing, Martina, which really, we have to make examples of people. Mm-hmm. We should stop pretending that Kenya is clean, there's no doping. There is doping, and we should talk about the guys who've been doping, guys who've been drinking themselves silly. Mm-hmm. You should mention somebody like Richard Chelimo, who died because of, you know,
liver cirrhosis.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Drinking too much.
No, I'm quoting about the old time.
Yes, okay.
The old time we didn't have these things. But the current.
But now it's the fashion. Doping is.
But we should also, you new people in the media, should also enlighten us. There is a time you used to write some quotes, especially on Saturdays. You used to educate people very much. What happened? We need it back right now. Yeah? I almost challenging the media. If you can create a good name for Kenya, and you can also create a very bad name for Miano.
Yes.
So can you do something?
Miano. The German guy is part of media.
What does it mean to our country? I mean, we are renowned for athletic success, and we are renowned for our hard work. When these allegations appear, and there may be one or two individuals doing it, how does it affect the country's reputation?
Well, actually, everybody has been out to bring Kenya down. Whenever you're up there, there's always somebody wanting to bring you down. Mm-hmm. And that's where Kenya is at the moment. Mm-hmm. You know, the John Ngugi case came up and then it was over. And now the doping allegations are coming up. And even as recently as the other day, we had the Berlin Marathon where Geoffrey Mutai won in a very good time. And Dennis Kimeto was right behind him. Mm-hmm. people are saying that he let him go so yeah. that you know he can win the World Marathon Major Series. Mm-hmm. This allegation of race fixing.
Yeah.
So everybody is trying to get a reason to get Kenya down. Mm-hmm. So we really need to educate these guys in AKA. Mm-hmm.
I think we also need to have brochures. Mm-hmm. Whenever we have got any sports meeting that we have, mm-hmm. because we cannot have athletes to train them at that particular time. Mm-hmm. There are some athletes who are in the bush. Mm-hmm. Who trains in the bush? Mm-hmm. We need to have brochures of the banned substances to give to those athletes such that after they finish, they complete the event, they go mm-hmm. and read them at home.
Okay, yeah, it's certainly a form of education.
It's a form of education. Okay.
Doping is without a doubt wrong and has terrible effects on your body and a country's honor. Kenyan athletes have been winning races for decades. They have broken world records and set high standards for all runners around the world. The few athletes who would rather cheat than work hard to win should not be allowed to tarnish the sport. Well, thank you very much for joining me in studio. This conversation doesn't have to end here. If you have any comments on what was discussed in today's show, please join the conversation on email and Twitter. Our handle is Zuku Athletics. See you next week on Setting the Pace.